Okay, Michael, so I want to talk a little bit about bias, and in particular the preference bias for K&N. So let me remind you what preference bias is. Preference bias is kind of our notion of why we would prefer one hypothesis over another, say all things, other things being equal. And what that really means is it's the thing that encompasses our belief about what makes a good hypothesis. So in some of the previous examples that we've used, it was things like shorter trees, smoother functions, simpler functions, Occam's razor. Those sorts of things were the ways that we expressed our preferences over various hypotheses. And K&N is no exception. It also has preference bias built in, as does every algorithm of any note. So I just wanted to go through three that I thought of as being indicative of this bias, and they're kind of all related to one another. So the first one is a notion of locality, right? There's this idea that near points are similar to one another. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah, that was really important and came out nicely in the real estate example, right? So that the whole idea, the whole thing that we're using to generalize from one thing to another is this notion of nearness.
Right. And exactly how that notion of nearness works out is embedded in whatever distance function we happen to be given. And so there's further bias that might come out based upon exactly the way we implement distances. So in the example we just did, Euclidean distance is making a different assumption about what nearness or similarity is compared to Manhattan distance, for
So
example.
is there like a perfect distance function for a given problem?
There's certainly a perfect distance function for any particular problem.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Not one that works for the universe, but one like, you know, if I give you a problem and you can work on it all day long, can you find, is there a notion that there's a distance function that would capture things perfectly?
Well, it has to be the case for any given fixed problem that there is some distance function that minimizes, say, sum of squared errors or something like that, versus some other distance function, right?
Okay.
That has to be the case. So there always has to be at least one best distance function given everything else is fixed.
That makes sense.
Right. Now, what that is, who knows? Maybe you finding it might be arbitrarily difficult because there's at least an infinite number of distance functions.
Well, yeah. I mean, I was thinking that if we're allowed to define distance functions to be anything we want, what about a distance function that said the distance between all the things that have the same answer is zero? And the distance between them and the ones that have different answers is, you know, infinity or something big. And then the distance function like somehow already has built in the solution to the problem because it's already put the things that have the same answers together.
Right, you could do that. And of course, doing that would require, again, solving the original problem. But yeah,
That's right.
so such a function has to exist, or, well, you know, there's always noise. What if there's noise in your data? You know, but some such function like that has to exist. The question is finding it. But I think the real point to take there is there are some good distance functions for a problem, and there are some bad distance functions for a problem. And how you pick those is really a fundamental assumption you're making about the domain. That's why it's domain knowledge.
Yeah, that sounds right.
Okay. So locality, however it's expressed through the distance function, that is similarity, is built into KNN that we believe that near points are similar, kind of by definition. That leads actually to the second preference bias, which is this notion of smoothness, right? That we are, by choosing to average and by choosing to look at points that are similar to one another, we are expecting functions to behave smoothly. Right, so you know, in the 2D case, it's kind of easy to see, right? You have these sort of points, and you're basically saying, look, these two points should somehow be related to one another more than this point and this point. And that sort of assumes kind of smoothly changing behavior as you move from one neighborhood to another. Does that make
Okay, I
sense?
mean, it seems like we're defining it to be pretty similar to locality.
In this case, so I'm drawing an example such that, you know, whatever we meant by locality has already been kind of expressed in the graph.
Okay.
And, you know, by picking, you know, this is really for pedagogical reasons. You can imagine this, you know, these are points that live in 77,000 dimensions, and it's impossible to actually visualize them, much less draw them. I could try. I mean, here's three dimensions, and here's the fourth dimension, and I think I'm going to get tired before I hit 77,000. But, you know, you kind of get the idea, right? That if you know, if you can imagine in your head points that are really near one another in some space, you kind of hope that they behave similarly. Right. Okay. So locality and smoothness, and I think these make sense. I mean, this is hardly the only algorithm that makes these kind of assumptions. But there is another assumption here, which is a bit more subtle, I think, which is worth spending a second talking about, which is for at least the distance functions we've looked at before, the Euclidean distance and the Manhattan distance, they all kind of looked at each of the dimensions sort of and subtracted them and squared them or didn't or took their absolute value and added them all together. But what that means is we were treating, at least in those cases, that all the features mattered. And not only did they mattered equally. Hmm. Right? So think about the last quiz I gave you, right? I said y equaled x1 squared plus x2. And you notice we got answers that were wildly off from what the actual answer was. Well, if I know that the first dimension, the first feature, is going to be squared, and the second one is not going to be squared, do you think either one of these features is more important or more important to get right?
Hmm. Okay, right. Trying to think about what that might mean. So if, it's definitely the case that you when you look for similar examples in the database, you want to care more about x1 because a little bit of a difference in x1 gets squared out, right? It can be lead to a very large difference in the corresponding y value. Whereas in the x2s, it's not quite as crucial. The if you're off a little bit more, then you're off a little bit more. It's just a linear relationship. So, yeah, it does seem like that first dimension needs to be a lot more important, I guess, when you're doing a matching than the second one.
Right. So, in fact, we probably would have gotten different. I'm not going to go through this, but we probably would have gotten different answers if in the Euclidean or the Manhattan case, we had, instead of just taking the difference between the first two, the first dimensions, we had taken that difference and squared it. And then in the case of Euclidean distance, squared it again. And then some of those things that were closer in the first dimension instead of the second dimension would have looked more similar, and we might have gotten better answers. That's probably a good exercise to go back and do for someone else.
Yeah, I was thinking of doing it right now, but yeah, I probably should leave it for other people.
Well, you can do it if you want to. So did you do it, Michael?
I did.
And?
So this is kind of now a mix between the Manhattan distance and the Euclidean distance. So I'm taking the first component, take the difference, square it, mm-hmm. take the second component, take the difference, absolute value it, and add those two things together.
Sure.
All right. So if I do that with one nearest neighbor, I still get that tie, but the output answer ends up being 12.
Hmm. Which is better than 24.7.
And that's better than 8, which is what it was before. So the 8 has gone up to 12. And the other one, which was, I think, 35.5, comes down to 29.5, closer, again, to the correct answer, which is 18. So in both cases, it kind of pushed in the right direction. It was using more of the answers that were relevant and fewer of the answers that were not relevant.
Right. There you go. So that notion of relevance, by the way, turns out to be very, very important and highlights a weakness of KNN. So this brings me to a kind of theorem or fundamental result of machine learning that is particularly relevant to KNN, but is actually relevant everywhere. Do you think it's worthwhile to mention it?
Sure. It sounds very relevant.
All right. Let's do it.